Well, hi, everybody.
Hi, Dan.
Thank you so much for coming. I have a hard time making these with my work schedule, so it means a lot to me that you've made whatever efforts you had to get here. I'm going to talk about Duruflé, the man, and Duruflé, the composer of the Requiem. Before I start, I just want to say I read several sources, but I want to acknowledge one in particular that I'll be quoting from a fair amount. I actually spent 1977 in Paris and got the chance to hear Madame Duruflé play many Sundays, and was surrounded by that whole French organ milieu. But having this, it was actually program notes by a guy named Dennis Keane, who's a concert organist and a choir director for a group called Voices of Ascension. He wrote fabulous program notes about Duruflé and the Requiem, and it kind of pulled together a lot of things that I remembered knowing and some things I didn't know. So Duruflé was born in January 1902, died June 1986. When he was 10, his father took him to the Cathedral of Rouen for Easter Sunday, and it was a big deal. They lived in a very small town, a pretty good distance from Rouen. But he got there, they got the grand tour of the cathedral, went to the services, saw the boy choir school, met with its director, all very exciting. And the day was great until at the end it all came crashing down when Duruflé's father told him that Maurice would not be going back home with him, that he would be staying there to be part of the choir school. Duruflé said, "That night in the dormitory, I sobbed on my bed." The choir director heard him and tried to lift his spirits by telling him all the great things that awaited him, including one day possibly playing the organ. Life at the school was pretty Spartan. Up at 6 every morning, no heat in the dorms. Prayers at 6:30, studies and rehearsal all day. But Duruflé loved it. Those 6 years would turn out to be possibly the most artistic influence on his life. Every weekday morning, the boys would study and rehearse the chants for this upcoming Sunday. And then they'd have evening rehearsals with the tenors and basses. They sang High Mass Sunday mornings and Vespers in the afternoon. The central music for all of this, of course, was Gregorian chant. So after such immersion, it's no wonder it just became part of his blood. In 1918, he left the choir school, moved to Paris to study with the organist Charles Tournemire. I'm going to mention a bunch of names. For those of you who know the organ people, that's great. Otherwise, you can just let it go by. But the gist of it is, there's this organ dynasty in France. It starts with César Franck. Tournemire studied with Franck and followed him as the organist of Sainte-Clotilde, which is a very, very important organ spot in Paris. So he would prepare for his examination at the conservatory with Tournemire, and later he'd study with Louis Vierne. Here's what Dennis Keane writes about this. Charles Tournemire and Louis Vierne were the two most important French organist composers of the day, both born the same year, 1870. They were classmates in César Franck's organ class. That'd be pretty cool. Duruflé was to study with both of them. First, it was impulsive, temperamental, brilliant Tournemire, organist at Sainte-Clotilde, where Franck had played. Particularly celebrated as an improviser, Tournemire would fill each week's mass with inspired improvisations that heightened the liturgical drama. He was big on drama. It was very much based on chant, but It was all about impulsive emotion, the color, the mysticism, the drama. These were the cornerstones of Tournemere's art. After a year of lessons, Tournemere thought Duruflé was ready to go and apply for the conservatory. Duruflé tends to be pretty self-effacing. He doesn't think he's ready yet, so he goes to Vierne and sees if he can study with him. A total contrast to Tournemere, Vierne was a charming, these are Dennis King's words, a charming, cultivated man. What makes you wonder what Tournemere was. And instead of improvising personal, mystical statements, Vierne was much more about very clear structure, impeccable structure and architecture. He's a far more rigorous and disciplined composer. And Keane says it was Duruflé's greatness that he was able to combine the exceptional imagination of Tournemere with the perfection of formal compositional techniques of Vierne into his own style, and we'll talk about that later in the Requiem. And ultimately, some people would say, surpassed both his masters. During his studies at the conservatory, Duruflé took first prize, which I think is a pretty big deal, in organ, harmony, accompaniment, counterpoint and fugue, and composition. That's a grand slam. He was in, maybe some of you remember Eugène Gigou's Grand Cordiolo that Michael Stairs played with brass. Well, Duruflé was in Gigou's organ class and Paul Dukas's class in composition and orchestration. Just so you can mention another person he bumped elbows with, Messiaen was also in that class. So he's in the circle. Duruflé arrived in Paris at the tail end of Impressionism. This seems like, I don't really want to cast aspersions on Duruflé, but Debussy died in 1918, the same year that Duruflé arrived. And the more classical, traditional music influence in Paris at the time, Gabriel Fauré, retired as director of the Paris Conservatory right as Duruflé entered. I'm not sure what that's all about, but I think it's coincidence. During his student years, Duruflé served as the assistant organist to Tournemere at Saint Clotilde, and then later to Vienne at Notre Dame. On graduating, his career really took off. He was highly in demand as an organist. His compositions were being performed by major performers and ensembles. In 1939, he gave the world premiere of Poulenc's organ concerto. And in fact, Poulenc sought him out for advice on how to register the organ for that piece. And so there's a fabulous recording, by the way, of Duruflé, who did the world premiere, with Georges Prêtre. It's still a classic if you can get a hold of it. In the 1940s, he was named professor of harmony at the conservatory, the best we ever had, said Messiaen. And he assisted Marcel Dupré, another big name in organ, with his organ class. This was fortuitous because in that class, he met a very talented Marie-Madeleine Chevalier. I haven't looked her dates up. I've seen reports that she was anywhere from 12 to 20 years as younger, but who cares? She's a fabulous organist. His first marriage got the Pope to annul it, because some people think because the Pope figured that if he married Madame Duruflé, they would do so much good for the church. The heck with the first marriage. So they become husband and wife in 1953, and she became co-titular organist at Saint-Étienne-du-Mont with Maurice. They were really rock stars of the organ world. I remember they would tour together, give joint recitals, packed houses, almost anywhere they wanted to go. Then in 1975, tragedy, they were involved in a near fatal head-on car crash in southern France. Both went through a series of major operations. Eventually, Madame Duruflé did return to playing at church, but her husband barely left his bed after that. I do remember hearing him at a rare performance in 77. There was a kind of a celebrity organ recital. I forget if it was on themes by Easter. I don't remember the details, but I remember hearing him play. He played a very simple piece, but it was just an honor to be there. I heard Madame Duruflé. All I can say is she totally rocked the whole world when she improvised at the ends of services. Maurice died in 1986. 3 years later, his wife did make a return, triumphal return to the concert stage. And that was for about 4 years when she had some unsuccessful shoulder surgery and had to limit herself to playing at church. And then she died in 1999. So the music. Well, if you love Duruflé's work, and I haven't found anybody who doesn't. Maybe I just don't know the right people, but but if you love his work, you probably found yourself thinking, where's the rest of it? Why isn't there more? There are only 14 published pieces. The upside of this is that there isn't any other composer I can think of, at least for my taste, whose work is this consistently perfect. There just isn't anything flawed in his published works, from what I can hear. According to, well, Dennis Keane quotes Madame Duruflé as saying that the reason he wrote so few works was the combination of exceptionally self-critical personality. He kept writing and rewriting and revising his works for years, even after they were published. And his jobs kept him, she said, very, very busy. When they played joint recitals, I think she kind of outed him, and she said she would play all the virtuoso pieces because he was too busy to practice. So that got me wondering, though, what was it like inside him? What were all these jobs that were so important that they would keep him from writing and practicing? Had perfection become an unhealthy obsession? The musical world moved on from Impressionism in the early 20th century. Think Stravinsky. Think Boulez. Was Duruflé becoming discouraged and isolated? Whatever was going on internally, it's wonderful to see how Duruflé could take all of his influence, Tournemire's wild improvisations, Fauré's classical leanings, Vierne's structure and architecture, and Debussy's Impressionism, not to mention the church and Gregorian chant, and meld all of these things into something wholly original and breathtaking. The Requiem began as an unfinished organ suite based on plain chants from the Mass for the Dead. It was Marcel Dupré, along with his publisher Durand, who convinced Duruflé to transform these pieces into a Requiem. He completed it in 1947, and dedicated it to the memory of his father. So I thought to myself, okay, so maybe no hard feelings about being ditched by the old man. Of the Requiem, Duruflé wrote, "This Requiem is entirely composed on the Gregorian themes of the Mass for the Dead. Sometimes the musical text was completely respected, the orchestral part intervening only to support or comment on it. Sometimes I was simply inspired by it or left it completely. For example, in certain developments suggested by the Latin text." So I think if the text itself took him away from the chant, no problem. Notably, he said in the Domine Jesu Christe, that's the third movement, the Sanctus and the Liberare. "As a general rule, I have above all sought to enter the particular style of the Gregorian themes." I thought this was really interesting. He said, "Therefore, I've done my best to reconcile as far as possible the Gregorian rhythms, which have been fixed by the Benedictines of Salem, with the demands of modern meter. The strictness of the bar line structure, with its strong beats and weak beats returning at regular intervals, is in effect difficult to be compatible with the variety and suppleness of Gregorian line, where there's only a succession of impetus, risings, and fallings. He said that strong beats had to lose their dominant character to take the same degree of intensity as the weak beats, in such a manner that the rhythmic Gregorian chant of the stressed Latin syllables could be placed freely on whichever beat came up in modern meter, which I think that means he needed to even out, flatten out the beat in order to let the stress of the Latin syllable determine how a beat was going to be handled rather than the bar line determining it. One other thing he said I found really interesting about this, so, you know, mostly a lot of times we think of the Duruflé and the Foray Requiems as kind of the angelic requiems. This requiem, he said, is not an ethereal work which sings detached from worldly anxiety. It reflects in the unchangeable form of the Christian prayer the anguish of man facing the mystery of his last ending. It is often dramatic or filled with resignation or hope or terror. And it tries to translate the human feeling in front of the terrifying, inexplicable, or consoling destiny. Let's play a little music. I want to start with the intro, but there's no way we can touch on everything. But I want you to listen just to the opening part of the intro and listen for how many seeming contradictions get swept up together in the opening measures. Dennis Keane makes reference to this sort of opening flow of music. I sort of think of it as there's a contradiction between the temporal and the timeless, the sensual and the spiritual, Gregorian chant and Impressionism. And it opens with the organ rolling, kind of rolling chords in the organ and violas that to me feel like this river of, this timeless river that's been rolling on forever and will roll on way past us, and we are stepping into it just at the first of the requiem. Sections are composed in a Renaissance contrapuntal style. But what's amazing here is Duruflé didn't rely on Renaissance harmony. So he's using the style, but he's speaking in his own harmonic language. He puts the Gregorian chant in the bass and alto parts with commentary melodies in the other two voices. So after all four voices get going, he then superimposes the melody in long notes, what's known as cantus firmus style, in a way that Bach would certainly be proud of. Like Bach, he's choosing the most rigid musical forms to express his most profound musical thoughts. Terrain that is practically an epic journey in itself. So I would listen to it that way. So, watch how freely he moves. There's definitely chant in it. A big part of it is chant, but it's very loosely played with. Highly charged, dramatic, just like the air. So we'll just hear just a touch of that. Totally different world. Skip to the Sanctus. Let me point out the very beginning of this, it's those rolling chords, kind of like the timeless river at the intro. It's funny how we all develop our own programs in our minds when we hear certain music. Dennis Keane thinks these angels remind him of the smiling angel and a sculpture at Reims Cathedral, which is in the heart of the Champagne District. And he has this idea that these angels have gotten into the champagne a little bit, which I don't quite hear, but if I had my own thing, which is coming up, it's a little bit like these old stereo records, the early stereo records, where you could hear like a parade go by. Here you're gonna hear the procession move closer and closer into the big corral. But what I hear is a jazzy backbeat coming up, boom, 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 boom. And I cannot help but hear that as the donkey Jesus is on clomping through the street. Here he comes. Thank you. I want to play for you. Actually, there's an interesting kind of controversy with the PA Jesu, which comes next. It's in the center of the Requiem. It's the only solo movement of the work. Originally, Duruflé had intended for a baritone soloist to be singing. He intended for the baritone soloist to sing the Hosia section of movement 3 and a short passage of Tremens Fata Sum Ego in movement 8. And that's how we're performing it, though Jean Bernard singing that part. Now, according to Madame Duruflé, later, Maurice Duruflé decided he preferred those passages sung by all the men in the choir. And I have heard recordings that way. And I think we've done that before with Alan. This instruction, common knowledge now, was told to Dennis Keane by Madame Duruflé. It also appears in the later printed copies. When the former baritone solos are taken by all the men, besides being preferable for these sections according to Dennis Keane, it also reinforces the architecture position of having one solo movement smack in the middle. There's another place where the Pia Jesu is actually a solo for a contralto or mezzo-soprano and a cello. Some conductors, he says, have recently misunderstood Duruflé's wishes about the baritone solo and think they also meant it for the Pia Jesu and now has given it to the whole alto section to sing. I actually have a recording like that, and I'm going to conclude with just a little of it because I think it's pretty convincing. One of the things that's different too about the Duruflé and the Foray, the Pia Jesu being sung by an adult, I think it carries a more of a gravitas. The Foray Pia Jesu tends to be lyric, pure, often sung by a boy. And you can hear more of like almost like a mother's pain at loss with some hope, but there's just something about the mature life looking at our ending. So let me just play just a little of this and we'll
thank you very much for coming,
and happy singing.